And the whole world is getting ready to see his glory. The whole world will be filled with his glory. That's what the Bible says. And it all began. And let me tell you, it doesn't seem like that the glory of the Lord is getting ready to fill the earth, because it seems like we're going backwards. Seems like terrorism is filling the earth, right? But the Bible says the glory of the Lord shall fill all the earth. But first there's going to be, Jesus said, first there's going to be wars and rumors of wars. Nation shall rise against nation, kingdom against kingdom. And now a nation is a nation. A kingdom is something else. What's a kingdom? A kingdom could be a concentration within a nation. You can have a kingdom, or it could be greater than just one nation. A kingdom can be greater than a nation. But in the days of the knights in shining armor, you'd have this group over here, and they had their own kingdom. And you'd have another group, and they'd have their king. And they built these castles, and they fought against each other. it was horrible what happened in the Dark Ages, in the Middle Ages. And you've got all these kingdoms, and you've got, but the kingdoms of this world have become the kingdom of our God. Yes. That's what the Bible says is going to happen at the end. But we're getting close to the beginning of the end game. In fact, I think we're already in it. I think we're already in the end game. And so nations are rising against nation, kingdom against kingdom. And we've got ISIS. What is it? It's a kingdom, and it's multinational. It's all over the world. They just decided they were going to be a nation. So they steal some land, and they said, now we have a caliphate. I don't even know what a caliphate is. Is that a flower? Is it a new stew? What is a caliphate? Caliphate is a kingdom. That's what it really is. And it's multinational. It's all over the whole world. And now we've got everybody trying to squash all of this. So it looks to me like that if God is going to make a kingdom of his kingdom, there'll be no end. And if the glory of the Lord is going to fill all the earth, then are we really going forward, or are we going backwards on this thing? We're going forward, because God's got to let everyone else beat themselves to death, and then he's going to step in and rule with a rod of iron. The millennium, some people say, well, the millennium, nobody's going to die. That's great. All right. What else about the millennium do you know? Well, in the millennium, everybody's going to be at peace. All right. We'll give you that. So everybody's going to be at peace. I wonder why. Okay, we'll get to that in a moment. And then we go, so in the millennium, the lion's going to lay down with the lamb. Oh, so that's going to be a real switch. You know, where we live today, the lion is going to eat the lamb, right? But in the millennium, God's going to do genetic tweaking. He's going to be doing tweaking and twittering and everything else. He's going to fix things the way it was in the very beginning. But the difference is going to be that in the millennium, people are going to live to be 1,000 years old, because the millennium is going to be 1,000 years long. But the reason is going to be peace, okay? The reason is going to be that everybody's going to listen to what God has to say and Jesus has to say, is because he's going to rule with a rod of iron.
Yes.
Yeah. Yes. Uh-huh. See, you didn't think about that. And those of you that don't like rules and regulations, I love rules and I love regulations. You know, I'd never buck the system, right? All right. So those of you that are not like me, you know, that love the rules and the regulation, it will not be optional in the millennium. And the beings that are put in charge, sometime I may talk to you about this, the beings that are going to be put in charge during the millennium, they're not going to have those taser guns. They're going to have those zap guns, you know. And when you want to do what you want to do, okay, all right, you're out of here. You're gone. And so the rest of the people are going to say, I think I want to do exactly what Jesus wants me to do. And everything that's done in the millennium, people are going to be saying, WWJD, huh? What would Jesus do? And that's what you're going to find everybody's talking about. I wonder what Jesus would do. We want to do what Jesus would do. Now you say, well, that's going to be a terrible time when God makes everybody serve him. No, it's not going to be a terrible time, because God is going to take the devil and box his ears and throw him in a chamber for 1,000 years. If there is no tempter, there should be no reason for you to want to do anything other than talk about Jesus and serve the Lord with joyfulness and gladness of heart. Because in that day, no one's going to be a millionaire.
That's right.
You say, what do you mean? It's not going to be socialism, folks. It's going to be theism. It's going to be God in charge of everything.
Hallelujah.
But there'll be no one sick. How about that? There'll be no one that doesn't have plenty. Everyone will have their heart's desire. Everyone's going to be footloose and fancy free. It's going to be the most wonderful time that the planet has ever known, except when man was put in the garden in the beginning. So it begins in the garden. It begins in what I want to refer to as the millennium. But it wasn't 1,000 years long. And it wasn't 1,000 years long because something happened. Something happened in the very beginning. In the very beginning, something happened that made man want to give this tremendous planet back to the devil again. See? So the state was like the millennium is going to be. It started out in perfection. Answer that for me, please, somebody. Oh, it's back over there. Maybe it's an angel supposed to answer that one. I don't know. Now, listen to me carefully, folks. It's not really too complicated, but it started in a garden. It started in a place where the lions were laying down with the lamb. It started in a place where God was all in all. It started in a place where God fellowshiped with man. Come on. And it's going to end in a place where God fellowships with mankind. And it's going to be the most blissful time on the planet. There will be no shortage of food, no shortage of funds. There will be no funds. The Bible speaks about come buy milk without money. Come buy without money. You don't need money. Money is a creation of greedy people that want to hold you in bondage. Your paycheck holds you in bondage. And they put in God we trust on it to legalize their lies. The greedy people that are over the money system, they don't trust in God at all. They trust in their ability to take all your money. And they print the money every time you get ahead and you're making big bucks. They ramp up the inflation. And when they ramp up the inflation, they take back everything you gained over the last 20 years. They can take it back in 1 year through inflation. And when the world, the wickedness in high places decided, we got the world right where we want it. Yes, amen. And now we're going to be able to transfer all the wealth, even of the poor man, into our hands. Yes, 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 yes. greedy people want to count their silver and count their gold and want all this. You know, they're just so greedy. They're not happy with having 8 billion, 10 billion, 58 billion, $100 billion. They're not happy with that. And they're so disillusioned. Bill Gates says, I'm not going to give any of my wealth to my children, just a smidget. I may give each one of my kids $500 million each when I die. The rest, all of this $100 billion I'm going to put into reducing the world's population. I'm going to invest it into AIDS. What a dummy. What a dummy. His wife says he can't hardly get up in the morning because he's so depressed. Why is he so depressed? Because he's got so much money. And he's got to worry about that money. He's got to, what are we going to do with this? So he gets with Warren Buffett and he says, Warren, what do you think we ought to do? Warren says, I've been thinking the same thing. I tell you what, I'm not going to worry about my money. I'm giving it all to you, Bill Gates, so you can worry. And so he gives it all to Bill Gates. Now, Bill Gates got twice the worries. He's got his worries and Warren Buffett's worries. And all of that money is really nothing. It's just an entry on a ledger. That's all it is. It's an entry on a ledger. Can you imagine a time that you go out to the store and the people working in the store are doing it because I was so bored, so I decided I would ask Jesus, could you give me something to do? You know, my wife went with me to preach a revival. I was preaching a revival up in Schenectady, New York. And so we go there, and my wife is a worker bee. You want to kill a worker bee? Take the hive away. He'll die. They got to work. And so my wife's up there, and so we're staying upstairs. The pastor's wife has their bedroom and their master bedroom downstairs, you know, and so my wife is thinking, well, there's a vacuum in the closet. I think I'll vacuum the upstairs. So she gets out and vacuums the upstairs. And she's so happy. She's so happy she's working. And I said, honey, you keep on vacuuming. Whatever makes you happy. Do you want to go see the museum? No, I just want to vacuum. You know, even to this day, the only way I get my wife out of America to the mission field is just grab one of my grandkids, and then she'll say, especially if I grab three, if three of them are going, I think I need to go so I can make sure they're okay. Why? You don't think I'll take care of them? Well, Charlie, you know. They'll be just fine. You know why? Because I'll tell them what to do. So we're up there in Schenectady. She's so happy. After about the fourth day of being in this revival up there, the pastor comes and says to me, your wife is upsetting my wife. And I said, what has she done? She's almost the epitome of perfection. And what could she possibly have done? She doesn't ever talk. She just chit-chats, you know. And she buys all the green stuff that your wife is selling. You know, she's buying everything, bucket loads of it. There was these green stuff you drink. What was that called again? Barley green. Yeah, that was a barley green deal. That would make you live to be 1,000 years old. And so, you know, she's doing all of this. And so pastor said to me, well, here's the problem. My wife thought she kept a clean house until your wife got here. I said, brother, the house was fine. It's my wife that just wants to vacuum. She wants to work. In the millennium, people will not be offended if you want to work. Because God made man to want to work. And if you don't work, you're not fulfilled. And the only thing you've got left to do is do drugs, sell drugs, buy drugs, kill people. Have excitement in your life. Yes. Do uppers, do downers, do sidewaysers, you know. I mean, you've got to understand that you've got to do something. Janet figured it out years ago with Danny. All they did, every other weekend during the summertime, we never saw them anymore. They used to go to Nag's Head on Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and Saturday night. They'd drive all the way home because they said to me, "We can't make it unless we're in church on Sunday morning." And I said, "Good, hallelujah. I have a faithful person here, you know." And then they figured it out. They wouldn't go to hell if they stayed a few Sundays. So every other Sunday they were gone. And she figured it out. All she's got to do in the next day is go down there with her fishing. That's all she wants to do. Just go down there and fish. So I didn't see them for years during the summertime. So, well, I'm exaggerating a little bit, honey, a little bit. So, see, because why? Because people want, they need to do something. You need a hobby if you're retired. It used to be when people retired, in the beginning of retirement, there was nothing for them to do, so they just died. Don't retire and die, folks. Retire and get a job. Find something to do. I love it when I walk into Walmart or Sam's Club and there's these old people at the front door. "Hello, how are you?" And they reek with money. You tell they got money. And sometimes I say, "What are you doing here?" "Well, you know, I got so bored with retirement, I thought I'd come out." It's not the money. It's not the money. No, they don't need the money. They got the money. So why are you working? Why are you doing what you're doing? Because there's something inside of you that says, if I'm not useful, I'm nothing. You've got to be doing something. And it's going to be a wild experience living in the millennium. Because in the millennium, I don't think you're going to get paid for what you do. You're just going to do it because it's so much fun. It's so much fun. We're going to have fun in the millennium. And we're going to have our lion in our backyard playing with the lamb. And the lion, you're going to feed him vegetables. "Hey, I need some more vegetables. Janet, could you bring me over some vegetables? Carol, I need some corn." "Okay, bring me some corn." "Why? My lion loves corn." God's going to reverse all the curses. The thorns are not going to grow after he refurbishes this earth with fire. It's going to be 1,000 years. But how did the world get so messed up? It's found in Genesis chapter 1, 2, and 3. Now let me just whet your appetite with this. Genesis chapter 1, verse 1 says this. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And that means God did something fantastic. He created the heavens and the earth. And then it says, and the earth was without form and void. There's a lot of Bible scholars today that believe that nothing existed in the whole universe until 6,000 years ago. But could there be a big difference between Genesis chapter 1, verse 1, and Genesis chapter 1, verse 2? And the word "and," could it be, it's that one of those words that is so archaic, it's such old Hebrew, it could be, now the earth had become waste and wild, and darkness was upon the face of the roaring deep. So in the beginning, if God made the earth, if he created the earth, in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth. He did it, all right? If he did it, why would God have created it ugly? Verse 2, that's ugly. So the only thing that God ever created that was ugly was the heavens and the earth. Because the earth was without, it was a blob. It had no form, and it was void. It was really void. And darkness was on the face of the deep. And then the Spirit of God moved upon the waters. So I'm just going to throw this out. I don't have time to explain it. But for you people that believe that the universe is older than 6,000 years, here's a very good explanation. In the beginning, God created, verse 1, the heavens and the earth. And it was perfect. And he gave it to Satan to take care of. Because he says to Job, where were you when the morning stars sang together? When everything was perfect. You know? And so the earth was created, the universe, the whole heavens and earth. And how long ago was that? Could have been eons ago. Eons, aeons, oons, pythons, it doesn't matter. And the earth now became, or was without form and void and darkness upon the faces of the deep. And the Spirit of God moved upon the waters. Because when the world became totally dead and desolate, then God had a legal right to step back in and say, I made it. You messed it up. You said, I'll ascend to the highest. I'll make my throne above God's throne. I'll be like God. And I cast you down to that earth. And then it's just a matter of a few hundred or a few thousand years. And there was no life left on this planet. And the only beings that were left on this were like similar to mankind, but they really weren't mankind, because I've never made anyone in my image after my likeness. But since you fell, devil, now I have a right to make the man the way I want to make him, because I now have a tempter. I didn't make you to be a tempter, but when you fell, one third of your angels fell underneath you. One third of my angels fell underneath you, God says, which, you know, if Satan was Jesus' archangel, and if Gabriel is the Father's archangel, and if Michael is the Holy Spirit's archangel, then if one third of those angels fell, it would make sense, because those one third angels underneath Satan were designed to follow Satan. They were in a hierarchy. They don't have free will and free choice. They can make a choice, but they can't come back on it. Why? Because no one tempted Satan to fall. There was no tempter. He was perfect, the Bible says. Satan was perfect in all his ways until iniquity was found in him. Now, I don't want to dwell on this part of it. And I know I've thrown many people, especially people who've never heard any of this line of reasoning before. Your local pastors will not tell you about this. They're scared to death of it. It used to be people taught about this, a pre-Adamic creation. There's a few verses in Jeremiah, a few verses in 1 Peter that allude to a creation that then was, the earth that then was, not the earth that we have now, not the way it is right now. And remember, during the refurbishing of this planet that had become without form and void and darkness was upon the face of the deep, the Bible says God made the whales. He made the birds. He created all of these beings on the earth. I'm not talking about human beings. I'm talking about the fish, the fowl, creeping things, all of these things. He made all of those. He created them for this earth. And the sun was, there was light already on the earth before God made, before he revealed the sun that was possibly already shining. But he couldn't come through to the earth. But when it comes to the vegetation, God never creates the vegetation again. He says to the vegetation, let the vegetation come forth. Did you hear what I just said? The vegetation just come forth. He didn't create the vegetation. It was already here. And that's why you can find tropical ferns at the North Pole and at the South Pole. You can find the archaeological and the geological fossils of ferns on the North and the South Pole, because at one time this world was a terrarium. And until the flood, there was a covering of water in the atmosphere that treated the entire planet on a clear night, just like it was a telescope. And that's why they knew the constellations better than our people knew it until Galileo invented the telescope, because the people could look up on a clear night, and with that great big bubble of water over top of us, it acted like a lens, and they were looking at Pleiades like it was 20 feet away. Is anybody listening to me? So you don't know what they knew back in Noah's day. But the waters from above broke down, and the waters from beneath came up, and the whole world was covered with water. But there was a canopy of water, and there was also an oxygenation level. Hello? Of 20% more oxygen than what we had. And if you give me 20% extra oxygen, I probably won't have anything wrong with my body. Right. We don't know. Also, that canopy of water kept out ultraviolet rays, which has a lot to do with your aging. So let me go back to when I was 1 year old. Put me in a bubble. Let me be the bubble boy and keep the ultraviolet rays out, and I may look like I'm 25. And some of you think I look like I'm 25 now. I know you think that, but that was before my chest of drawers disease, where my chest fell into my drawers. And so I want you to understand that things were different back then. How different were they, Pastor? I don't have a clue. But how different are they going to be in the millennium? I don't really have a clue about that either, but I know the lion's going to lay down the lamb, but like the lamb. So obviously the lion's not going to be eating the lamb. Maybe the lamb will eat the lion. I'm not sure, you know. No, it says they're going to be friends. So God had a world. He had heavens. He had an earth. And it became messed up. And then Genesis tells you the account of how God refurbished the earth. And in this refurbishing, he says to himself, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, the three of them said, let us make man in our own image and after our own likeness. And they said, great idea. But I'm sure that didn't catch God by surprise, because before the world was framed, God knew you. So it was already in the mind of God, and God knew in his foreknowledge that Satan was going to say, I think I want to be like God. I'll ascend to the highest. I'll make my throne above God's throne. I'll be like God. And one day, Satan is looking over the shoulder of God when God walks into this garden that he had made so beautiful, and he said, this is it. This is the dirt we're going to make man out of. Because man, one day, is going to think he's so important that I'm going to make him out of 98 cents worth of minerals and dirt. But I am so keen on what I do, I can take 98 cents and make not a 6 million, not a 6 billion, not a 6 trillion, but a 6 quadruple, whatever, million, billion, trillion dollar man. And God stoops down and he starts forming this man. And Satan says, I'm not impressed. We got angels that look better than this. Okay, so you make some mud hair, muddy looking hair there. God says, yeah, but wait till you see what I do when I pick this clay image, this clay matter, and I pull it up to my mouth. And so he makes this man, and he looks just like, is in the image and likeness of God. But the problem is, God added a dimension to man that he did not give to angels, And he did not give to any other creations on any other planets or any prior creations on this planet. Because now when he breathes into man, Satan sees that man has a body made out of clay, and the clay begins to change to flesh. So we've got a physical image. Then he sees when God's breathing into this man, man has a soul. He's got a mind. He's got a will. He's got emotions. But what is this that's happening now? As God's breathing in, the clay becomes flesh, and the mind becomes soulish, becomes, he sees something going on in the mind. But God continues to breathe into him, this man called Adam. And when he breathes in him a little longer, Satan sees something forming here. And he says, what's that? What's that? What's that? What's that? God says, just a minute. What's going on there? And God finishes breathing into man. And he says, Satan, meet Adam. He has a body. He has a soul. But he has our spirit. The Father, Son, and Holy Spirit carved out a capacity for man to have the Spirit of God. And there's a part inside of this part. Satan saw something churning, and he realized that this being knew God, had the capacity to know God. It was known of God. Anybody listening to me?
Yes.
It's getting late. Maybe we should quit right now. Got too much extra time. Bill must have stopped the clock. Where's Joshua? Did the sun stand still? Folks, listen to me. There is a being on the planet that is in the image and likeness of God. And when God starts dealing with this man, Adam, Satan begins to realize he never dealt with the angels like he's dealing with Adam.
Yes. Hello.
Because when God made the angels, he said to the angels, that's a tree, that's a river, that's a creek. Get it all. I'm downloading it into you now. And the angels knew. And the angels were created beings, but they were not a wombed being. And the angels are male. Don't let anybody tell you that the angels are female. The angels are not female. Sorry, ladies. They're all men. But Adam was capable of reproduction. And God saw it was not good for man to be alone. So he made the wound man for him. That's what woman means, wound man. And he separates. And even in the creation of every boy and every girl, there's a period of time where no one can tell for sure if it's male or female. And even in the last days before the birth of the baby boy, God zips up the little boy. And it's obvious that he's zipped up. And he does not zip up the little girls. And so we have in this creation God dealing with man on a level that Satan never saw God deal with angels. He says, okay, Adam, you're 3 days on this planet now, and I've decided put you in a deep sleep. We got to make a helper for you. Somebody that'll be a completer to you. Somebody that'll be better than you. We're going to give her more assets than you got. Mentally, physically, spiritually. She's going to be attached to our heart, the heart of us, God. You're just attached to the brain of God, man. That's why your man is so dumb. It's not his fault. Because just before childbirth, God washes across the man's brain and says, cut off 75% of the connectors between the right and left side of the brain. So the man is brain half, you know, 3/4% not all there. And the woman, he leaves all the connectors. And that's why a woman can beat a man in an argument, because she throws it when she's losing in the arena of reason, because man can beat a woman in the arena of reason. But when she's losing in that arena, she kicks it back into third gear, gives it the gas, and she goes into the crying mode. Oh, I don't know what I'm going to do. And while she's in that crying mode, the man leaves his arena of reasoning, and he pulled into the lady's emotionalism, and he says, oh, honey, please, no. Do anything, but don't cry. No, stop that crying now. And while she's in this arena of emotion, her creative side is kicking in, and she starts going, and her computer starts whizzing around faster than the speed of light, faster than a speeding bullet. She can leap tall buildings with a single bound. She becomes the superwoman, and she'll stop crying all of a sudden. Have you ever noticed a woman that's in this emotional realm can stop crying just like that? She goes, and that's why I say this, and she's got him. And she walks out of the room, and the man's going, what just happened? She just beat you. She pulled you into her minutia, and then she slapped you around with it, and then she walks out of the room, and you've got to admit, after the emotional display, you'd better let her win, even if you know you cannot reason her at a later point. You don't, because after all, she is your honey. You don't want to shut that down. You don't want to shut her down, because you've shut her down before, and what you got was nothing. And so God makes this woman better than the man, and he puts them in this garden, and he says, look, all you got to do is keep the garden. What do you want me to do, God? Just keep it. What does that mean? Do I have to till the soil? No. You have your word, and your word can till the soil. You walk through the garden, you say, ground, be stirred up underneath that apple tree. Lightning, strike over here so we can get some more potassium in the soil. And with his word, he kept the garden. He was like God. He used his mouth, not his muscles. And so the woman is one day standing next to the only tree that she's not allowed to eat of. And he's not allowed to eat of. And the Bible says clearly, Adam was with her, standing right there. So here's Eve, here's Adam. There's the tree, and there's the devil. And so the devil says, why don't you have some of this fruit? And Eve looks at Adam, and Adam looks at Eve, and Adam's not talking to the devil. So that's her cue. Because even in the garden, there was only one form of communication. Tell a woman. They didn't have telegraph and telephone. They just had telewoman. And he had told her, we're not allowed to eat of this. And so she goes, well, God said we can't eat it and we can't touch it. Oh, she's just added to the word of God. He didn't say you couldn't touch it. He said you just can't eat it. Why are they at that tree when there's 1,000 other trees that they can do whatever they want to do with those trees? Why are they at that tree? Because for 3 or 4 days, they've been going there every day. Why is it that we can't have this one here? Curiosity killed the cat and killed Adam and Eve too and all of us. So we're here just looking. They don't have anything else to do. It's the best game in town. It's the only thing they're not allowed to do. And human nature being what it is, they're curious and they're just there. Satan says, God knows that when you eat of this, you'll be as smart as he is. How smart do they need to be? They did not know good and they did not know evil. They only knew the best, which was God. And this was the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. But they already had the best. And they traded the best for good and evil. And it's not the tree of the knowledge of evil. It's the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. They only knew God. They knew his presence. They knew that anything foreign to that was not right. They couldn't sin if they tried. There was no sin in that garden except don't eat that tree. That was it. They're there. And Satan was more subtle than any of the beasts that God had made. The serpent was. And Satan was in that serpent. And the serpent says to the woman. And the woman says to the serpent. And the serpent says to the woman. And the woman says to the serpent. And Adam's standing there like. And Eve is there looking at her husband. And he's not saying anything. And when the serpent says, just take a bite. It's going to be all right. Try it. You'll like it. She sees Adam is not negating that. Adam is not stepping in. Adam is not protecting her from it. She realizes from Adam's demeanor that he wanted to eat it too. And so she takes it and eats it and says, I didn't die, because God said, the day you eat of it, you will truly, surely die. Eternal life will leave you. You will no longer live forever. Your body will become a body that can die. Genetically, I made you so pure, you can never die unless you eat that fruit. And so the woman is there realizing the man wants to eat it too. She takes of it and gives it to him, and he did eat. And now the only two beings on the planet that can redeem mankind are both dead, spiritually dead. And after they ate of that fruit, I believe they had a bright light shining all from inside of them that covered their naked bodies. And I believe after about an hour or so, the light became to be dim. And where they could not see each other's body, they now could see each other's body. They couldn't see it before. They could feel each other, but they couldn't see each other. They could hug each other, but they couldn't see each other. It didn't matter if she was fat or skinny.
That's right.
He never knew except what he could feel. God made us like lights. He's the Father of lights.
Yes.
The radiant glory of God. What do you think you're going to wear in heaven? You think you're going to go to the heavenly store up there and buy yourself a gown? No. You're going to be like a bulb. You're going to be like, whoo, glowing, shining, clothes of righteousness. No one could see each other. Little babies would have been born like bright lights coming out of the bright light of the woman. And there was man, there was woman, and they realized, we're not supposed to be looking at each other, because obviously when we were made, when God created and fashioned us, he created us with his presence and his glory, because the glory of the Lord was filling all the earth back then in those days. And that's why I say God wants the glory of the Lord to fill the earth in the latter days. Amen. And so there's this man and this woman, and they get some fig leaves and cover their bodies. And I can tell you, if you go with me to Hawaii, you can cover your flesh with brush. Trust me, you can. There are women in Hawaii, and all they got on is grass skirts, and then they got a top on, of course. Some of them don't. The point is, you can fix your covering without shedding the blood of an animal. But without the shedding of blood, there's no remission of sins. Hebrews 9:19. Put it up there. Hebrews 9:19. You're going to see that they sinned. And so God had to make them coats of animal skins, showed them how to do it. But when Moses had spoken every precept of the people according to the law, he took the blood of calves and of goats with water and scarlet wool and hyssop and sprinkled of all the people. Verse 22. And almost all things are by the law purged with blood. Without the shedding of blood is no remission. You can't get rid of sin without the shedding of blood. And in the Old Testament, the shedding of the blood of bulls and of goats could not make man's conscience free from sin. You know what one of the biggest problems you have today as a Christian? You want me to tell you? Everybody better listen to this, because this is the most dangerous part of Christianity. The most dangerous part of Christianity is that when you say, Lord, forgive me of my sins, he cleanses you, he washes you in his blood, in the blood of Jesus, and you don't even have any consciousness of sin. You're so cleansed that you feel like, woo, this is fantastic. What I did has been taken away, nailed to the cross, put into the sea of forgetfulness. And that's one of the most dangerous parts of salvation, because it's so easy to fall into the trap of sinning, knowing that you can be cleansed again and again and again and again and again. And so you live a carnal life and you stay slipping in and out of sin, because you can get your conscience clean. But that's why Paul the Apostle wrote, should we sin that grace should abound? Horrors, no. Horrors, no. Don't sin so grace can abound. Right. Quit sinning. Believe God to take that sin away from you, because God doesn't want you to keep trampling on the body and the blood of Jesus Christ. Amen. In Genesis chapter 3, go back with me to Genesis chapter 3. When man sinned, here's this man and this woman right there at the only thing they're not supposed to partake of. Here's this sly, slick, subtle serpent. And here's what the Bible says. The serpent was more subtle than any beast in the field. Then the Bible says, listen carefully, he was more subtle. But what Satan said through the snake, through the serpent, was this. God's a liar. What's subtle about that? God's not telling the truth. God knows you're missing out on something. There's nothing subtle in that. Where was the subtlety of the serpent? The subtlety of the serpent was simply this, that when man and woman were standing in front of the tree, Satan said to the woman said to the serpent, the woman said to the serpent, all he did was break God's chain of responsibility. God made man responsible for the garden. God made man responsible for the woman. He wasn't as intelligent. He wasn't as great as the woman. God made him a greater helpmeet than what he had, than what he was. The woman's a superior being to man. You men that don't believe that, just trust me. One day you're going to find out. When you have a cold or when you have the flu, you get up like this. Oh, I got the flu. I think I'm going to just stay home today, honey. When your wife gets up with the flu, she says, I don't have time for the flu. I'll press through this thing. I'll get the kids off to school. I'll help the kids with their school. I'll make the supper for my husband. She works with the flu. You die with the flu. And you say to your wife all day long, and she starts praying hard for you, oh, God, heal my husband so he can get out of here. This guy, what's his name, Jeff somebody, you got that dummy on his hand. He says, I think my house is haunted. And Jeff says, why do you think your house is haunted? He says, because my wife is there. And when I go home, she says, get out, get out. There's some truth in that somewhere. You got to dig deep in it. You'll find it. Some of you will get it. Some of you are slow. Some of you men are really slow, but you'll get it one day. They're happy when you go to work. Trust me. So you go. They're standing right there. And all Satan did was deal with the woman, and the woman deal with the devil. And that's why bill collectors never call the husbands. He calls at 4:30 when you're home and he's not home yet. They call and say, my name is Charlie Bennett and I'm calling from the First National this or that, and you haven't paid your bill. And if you don't pay your bill, and the woman goes, oh, God, help us, oh, God. And she runs in and gets the checkbooks and writes the check, knowing that her husband's going to fuss at her. But she says, I just had to. That man was so mean to me on the phone. Well, I figured all this out by going to a seminar. I said to my wife one day, never again are you allowed to talk to a bill collector. Well, what am I going to tell him? You're going to tell him, I'm not responsible for the bills. You have to talk to my husband. And I will talk to them. Now, the way I talk to them is this. When they call up and she says, I told you they were going to call. So they say, Mr. Bennett, is that you? I say, absolutely, this is me. And they said, you owe this bill. You got to pay this bill. I said, sir, let me just say something. I don't have any money. I'm not going to worry about it. You do what you got to do. Thank you for calling. Click. See? The woman hangs on, listens to every evil, devious word the man's got to say, gets herself all motivated to go do something that her husband doesn't want her to do anyway, because the woman is not responsible for the family. The man's responsible for the family. Somebody shout amen. Amen. So they go like this. The man should have said, devil! I'm over here, devil. Yeah. She's not responsible. She was not made when this all started. I was made. Right. I'm responsible. Shut up. Right. Don't talk to my wife. Eve, do not talk to him ever again. That's right. And if he'd have done that, we would all be living in millennium right now. Adam would still be alive on the planet. There would be no wars. The world, we would already be populating Venus, because one day God's going to give us the morning star for our inheritance. Somebody shout amen. Amen. So with all that being said, let me break it down to you. Genesis 3:15. Genesis 3:15. I'll put enmity between thee and the woman, between thy seed and her seed. It shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel. Because the seed of the woman is going to bruise your head, devil. And the seed of your seed, devil, is going to bruise his heel. Satan, you can't win. I'm going to win. I'm going to beat your brains out, devil. I'm going to bruise your head. And God so loved the world. Somebody say, God so loved the world, that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Next week, I'm going to show you what the blood of Jesus really did, and how the blood of bulls and of goats could not save man, but the blood of Jesus can. Because without the shedding of blood, there's no remission of sins. Next week, I'm going to preach to you about the blood of Jesus Christ, God's Son, cleanses me from all sin. 1 John, put it up. 1 John chapter 1, verse 7. 1 John, not St. John, 1 John, chapter 1, verse 7. It's coming. Wait for it. Wait for it. 1 John, chapter 1. Yep, the computer's frozen. If we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another. And the blood of Jesus Christ, God's Son, cleanses us. 1 John, chapter 1. Go to verse 1. Chapter 1, verse 7. If we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another. And the blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, cleanses us from all sin. Verse 8. The next verse. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. Verse 9. If we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. There's something supernatural that happens when a man says, oh God, forgive me of all my sins. When you say to God, you can do it all by yourself. You can, sitting right where you're sitting, watching on the television, it doesn't matter. People see this for days later, for months later. They may tune in. And wherever you are, however you're able to access this from foreign countries, something supernatural happens when you say with all your heart, Father God, I am messed up. And you can say to the Father God, you can say, Father God, Pastor Bennett says, he's messed up too. Just tell God I'm messed up. You can say, Father God, Pastor Bennett's messed up. And if he's messed up, I know I'm messed up. And then say, but you said in your word, if I confess my sins, you are faithful and just to forgive me of my sins and cleanse me from all unrighteousness. And that's where it all begins. And that's where it all ends. It doesn't matter what happened. It doesn't matter how subtle the devil was. It doesn't matter how the devil talked to the woman, and the man didn't take his place and the woman didn't keep her place. And all of that doesn't matter. What matters is when mankind all screwed up and gave the world back to the devil, God says, Son, the Father says to the Son of God, Son of God, Jesus, he says, my son, my only son. The Father says, I'm not going to replace the 1/3 angels that fell with more angels. I'm going to give you a bride. And in the garden, there was a wedding. And all through the Bible, there's a wedding. And there's family, because God's a family God. And at the end, in the book of Revelation, chapter 22, it ends in a wedding. Why? Because you are part of the greatest experiment of all the universe, of all the eons past, of all eons future, that in the eons to come, God is going to show forth. He's going to showcase you and me by saying, this, my son's body, was formed from all those beings that wanted to serve me and didn't have to. And throughout the ages to come, the new Jerusalem is going to come down and be as if Christ himself hugs that new Jerusalem. And in the new Jerusalem is the bride of Christ. Those people that served him with all their heart, that put up with that husband they had, that put up with that family they had, that put up with their wife that they had. The people that sold out to God will be part of the bride of Christ, because from the body of Christ, God's going to take a bride for his son. And that bride is the most precious part of God's plan forever and ever, world without end. Amen. And if you had any idea what God had planned for this earth and what he had planned for you in eternity, you're not going to sit around twiddling your thumbs. You will rule and reign with Christ. You have a supernatural, eternal inheritance through Jesus Christ. Amen. Father, thank you for this word today. Thank you that we can confess our sins and you will forgive us and cleanse us. From every pill we've popped, from every vein we've shot things into, from every sin we've committed, every lustful thought we've ever had, thank you that one day Satan will be put away forever and ever, and we will be able to live in without sin forever and ever. We will not even have the substance or the desire for sin. We will live in a state of blissful testimony, a state that says, I know I am free. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name, amen. Would you stand with me to your feet as Justine leads us in a song? I want every person here today, if you're here today, I want you to slip your hand up. If you know that Jesus is in your heart, slip your hand up. I'm scanning this place right now. I'm looking for anybody that couldn't put your hand up. I'm not going to call you out. Just be honest with me. Do you know that Jesus is in your heart? If you know he's in your heart, sort of hard for me to get anybody saved if everybody's got their hand up. So next week, bring some people that can't raise their hands, please. I'm asking every person here today to raise your other hand and worship with me today. Out of a heart that's overflowing with emotion and a heart that's saying, thank you, Father. Come on, somebody say, thank you, Father.
Thank you, Father.
For your wisdom.
For your wisdom.
For making this universe.
For making this universe.
For sending your son, Jesus.
For sending your son, Jesus.
For me.
For me.
To cleanse me.
To cleanse
from my sins. Help me serve you, Father. And worship you every day of my life. In Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you.